Hi everyone, I'm Tyler Long, Delivery Manager for Tunnels on Queensland's Cross River Rail Project. Before I start, I'd like to share with you acknowledgement of country. We acknowledge the traditional owners of this country and the place of our meeting and recognise the continuing connection to lands, waters and their communities. We wish to pay our respects to the culture of our First Nations peoples and to elders past, present and emerging. Thank you. Allow me to give a brief introduction. I'm a civil engineer and I've been involved in the design and construction of major projects over the last 20 years. I started here at the Cross River Rail Delivery Authority in the middle of 2018. Before this project, I worked on Brisbane's Clem Jones Tunnel, Airport Link Tunnel and Legacy Way Tunnel. Also, I previously worked as a consultant and was seconded to the UK to work on the Channel Tunnel Rail Link and St Pancras King's Cross Underground Station redevelopment project. So let's just jump right into it. What is a TBM? A tunnel boring machine, or TBM, is a machine used to excavate underground tunnels with a circular cross-section through various soil and rock strata. Predominantly, the following are the four most commonly used TBMs. These are earth pressure balance machines, or EPBMs, mixed shield, slurry shield machines, and double shield TBMs. An earth pressure balance machine, they're terrific in soft cohesive soils with low water permeability through stratas such as clay, silt and loam. The green rotating cutting wheel equipped with tools is pressed onto the tunnel face and excavates the material. The soil enters the excavation chamber through openings where it mixes with a soil paste. The bulkhead transfers the pressure of the thrust cylinders to the soil paste, pushing it forwards towards the cutting wheel. This is where it needs to maintain a state of equilibrium between the two opposing pressures. The pressure of the soil paste in the excavation chamber equaling the pressure of the surrounding soil and groundwater in front of the cutter wheel. As the machine excavates forward, the amount of excavated soil entering the excavation chamber will be offset by the amount of soil paste removed by the machine's screw conveyor. This makes it possible to balance the pressure conditions at the tunnel face, avoids uncontrolled inflow of the soil into the machine and allowing for high advance rates and minimizing the risk of heave or sediment at the surface. The next machine is mixed shield. These are great for assorted ground conditions such as sand, gravel, high water permeability and water pressures. These machines can measure from 3.7 meters and up to 19 meters in diameter. It has a similar concept to the EPBMs. However, the support pressure in a mixed shield excavation chamber is precisely managed using an automatically controlled air cushion. This means that varying geologies and high water pressures of more than 15 bars can be controlled safely during excavation. Slurry shield machines are generally referred as microtunnels and are widely used by utility companies for new stormwater or water mains. Its range is typically between 0.4 to 4 meters in diameter. These are used in almost all ground conditions with high water pressures. The soil to be excavated is removed using a cutter head adapted to the respective geology. This makes it possible to use the machines in almost all geological conditions. In soft soils, the mixed geologies, standard or mixed ground cutter heads are used, while a rock cutter head with disc cutters is used for tunneling in stable rock formations. Now, introducing our last but not least, double shield TBMs. These machines are capable of to excavate through all kinds of stable and unstable rock. Under stable geological conditions, the combination of methods allows for the installation of concrete segments parallel to tunnel excavation, achieving very high tunneling performances. These machines are therefore perfectly suited for excavating long tunnels in hard rock. These TBMs also ensures a very high level of work safety for TBM personnel in geological fault zones due to its ability to operate under single shield mode. Now let's take a moment now to walk through some of the geology of Brisbane to give you a sense of what we're working with and why we selected the tunnelling methodology and machines for the Cross River Rail project. Before settling on the alignment, we undertook extensive geological investigation to develop a geological model to assist in the selection of the tunnelling methodology and the machines for the Cross River Rail project. Over 207 boreholes were drilled and a bathymetrics survey of the Brisbane riverbed was undertaken. Brisbane is actually quite blessed to be located on very hard rock, sometimes too hard to even make some tough tunnellers cry. This slide illustrates the different types of geology along the Cross River Rail alignment. The green rock strata shown is called Brisbane Tuff, that's spelt T-U-F-F, and the lavender colour profile predominantly for the rest of the alignment is a rock named Nerrinlin Fernvale. We de-risked the project by designing the entire alignment through rock and very familiar to the ground conditions from Clem Jones Tunnel, which was constructed over 10 years ago. We altered the alignment to suit and learn from other projects. This slide shows some of the core samples taken along the alignment. So Brisbane Tuff is a very competent to very high strength volcanic imbrite with a compressive strength from 5 to over 100 MPa or megapascals. So for your information, household concrete is typically around 25 MPa. As a fun fact, Brisbane Tuff isn't formed from volcanic lava. It's actually from the pyroclastic material ejected from the volcanic explosion millions of years ago, and the heated pyroclastic material, when it falls onto the ground, would infuse or weld into the existing rock or soil. The other rock is Nerrinlin Fernvale, which is a medium to high strength phyllite with localized quartz veins. It's typically 5 to over 120 MPa in strength. And last, Aspley-Tingalpa formation is a low to medium strength interbedded sandstone, siltstone and conglomerate. This normally varies between 20 to 25 MPa in strength. So, what is Cross River Rail? Cross River Rail at a glance will deliver 10.2 kilometres of new rail line, 5.9 kilometres will be twin tunnels, 4 new underground stations, 8 rebuilt surface stations, including a new station at Exhibition, a new European Train Control System, or ETCS, signalling system, 3 new Gold Coast stations at Pimpamar, Helensvale North, and Merrimack, and 5 new station precincts. The Cross River Rail alignment is shown in blue on this map. As I mentioned, 4 new underground stations is being constructed at Bogger Road, Woolloongabba, Albert Street and Roma Street. With the introduction of Cross River Rail, it will deliver the biggest change to the region's rail network in decades. It will change the way we travel across Southeast Queensland, connecting people, communities and businesses. Cross River Rail will be more than just a rail project. It's a city and region shaping investment that will trigger a wave of urban renewal. Currently, there's only one river rail crossing into Brisbane City, which is the Merivale Street Bridge, and it's nearing capacity. So with the introduction of Cross River Rail as another river crossing, it will unlock the bottleneck and increase the capacity on the network for more frequent rail services and greater connectivity to other public transport. This in return will ease road congestion as more people choose to travel by rail. This project at a glance Woolloongabba will be the main tunnelling site for the entire project. The northern drive, shown in orange, will be 3,570 metres of twin bored tunnel constructed by two TBMs. The southern drive, shown in blue, is 870 metres of twin mined tunnel constructed by two road headers. In addition, 16 cross passages spaced at approximately 240 metre centres will also be constructed along the alignment. These will be constructed by rock hammer, drill and blast, and or using wire rope saw. This slide shows the long section of the Cross River Rail alignment. The tunnels will be 42 metres below the riverbed, so that little blue river you see in the image, and at its deepest point, 58 metres below the surface of the Kanga Point cliffs. As I mentioned before, the Woolloongabba site will be the launch pad for the TBMs. This is an area of the Woolloongabba site with the world-famous Gabba cricket ground in the background. We've been planning for this site for 2.5 years in preparation for tunnelling. The following still images show you some of the construction work currently underway at site and will give you a sense of the scale of the project. This is just one of currently 12 active work sites across Brisbane CBD. This is an aerial photo of the station box during excavation works at the Gabba, which was taken about 6 months ago. You can see and count the high number of excavators in the station box, busily hammering out the rock and loading out the spoil. And this is a recent aerial of the station box. At the deepest level in the box, it is about 33 metres below the surface. Six road headers and two TBMs are excavating caverns and tunnels across the entire Cross River Rail project. Two road headers are each operating at Woolloongabba, Albert Street and Roma Street stations. Allow me now to introduce the project's two amazing TBMs. And here we are. Here are two ready for action TBMs. Our TBMs have already travelled a great distance by the time they arrived to the Woolloongabba worksite. Both these machines were made by Heron Connect and were actually used on the City Metro project. When they had finished their excavation on that project, these machines were shipped back to Heron Connect's factory in China, where majority of the parts were reconditioned. With the larger Cross River Rail diameter, new cutter heads and shields were manufactured. Each TBM weighs 1,350 tonnes and are approximately 165 metres long. That's like 1.5 times the length of the Gabba Stadium. Large TBM units were shipped back to Brisbane, where both TBMs were assembled at Heron Connect's Brisbane facility to undertake factory acceptance testing. The first TBM unit was delivered to Woolloongabba, site in December 2020. Here's just a schematic of the TBM. The key parts of the machines are the cutter head, the front shield, the telescopic shield, the gripper shield and the shoe, and the tail shield. The front shield with its cutter head and main bearing weighs over 270 tonnes. It is made out of Hardnox 400 and abrasion resistant steel and has 39 cutter discs, each weighing 159 kilograms. One of the key features of a double shield TBM is the gripper shoe. The gripper shoe uses hydraulic jacks that extends the units out to hold it firm against the cut rock. This provides the steady platform for the main thrust cylinders to push the cutter head forward. As the cutter head rotates, the rolling movement of the cutter disc smashes and pulverizes the rock into small pieces or chips of rock. Water jets can cool the cutter tools and reduce dust formation. Buckets installed in the cutter head take up the excavated material. Due to gravity, it slides to the centre of the machine through muck chutes, while the cutter head rotates and then falls onto the machine's conveyor belt. During normal operation, double shield TBMs offer uncompromised safety for all TBM staff by eliminating the risk of exposure to any unsupported ground. Here are some of the key facts for the main shields. The cutter head diameter is 7,230 millimeters. It weighs 650 tons. So with all the 12 backup gantries behind the TBM, it weighs about 1,350 tons. The length of the main shields is approximately 13 meters, but with all the gantries strung up, it would total 165 meters. The main drive delivers 2,800 kilowatts or 4,910 kilonewton meters. Its rotation speed at maximum is 7.35 revolutions per minute. As mentioned before, there's 39 cutter discs, there's 10 main thrust cylinders which pushes the cutter head forward, and then there's also behind the gripper shield are 18 auxiliary thrust cylinders. And those cylinders are used to push the whole machine forward by the actual width of each segment lining. Here's a photo of the arrival of the TBM's gripper shield to site. It was delivered under full police escort and some very tricky manoeuvring under rail power lines, bridges, and even some trees. And this is the TBM's telescopic shield being lowered into the station box by the gantry crane. That's about 270 tons of metal being lowered. And the maximum capacity of the gantry crane, for the information, is 280 tons. This time lapse will give you an idea of the site works involved into setting up the launch, launching the TBMs at Woolloongabba site. Appears to have an IT glitch. I might skip along. What was it playing? It's playing. All right. Moving along, and this photo shows the first TBM assembled within the northern cavern, and the very excited TBM team ready to launch her. Crossroad Rail's TBMs were named after two groundbreaking Queensland women in honour of their outstanding contributions to the state. The first TBM launch was named ELSA, after trailblazing engineer Professor ELSA Shepherd, AM. While the second TBM is known as Mel, in honour of pioneering feminist Mel Thornton AM. The thinking behind the choices is that these two women have forged ahead, led the way, and helped create a better future for this state, just like the Crossroad Rail TBMs will. Professor Shepherd has blazed the way for women entering fields such as engineering, while Mrs. Thornton has been at the forefront of women's rights and social justice issues in Queensland. This is TBM ELSA in the starting position. Some fast facts about the TBMs. They are like underground factories. A crew of up to 15 people will work on a TBM at any one time. And each TBM is fully equipped with crew facilities and toilets. So how does a TBM work? This video will explain. Each of the two massive TBMs took about 2 months to be assembled at the Gabba. The TBMs consist of a conveyor, thrust cylinders, gripper shoe, segment erector, shields, and cutter head. The cutter head is the main cutting tool, and it is electrically powered to rotate while applying pressure to the tunnel face. It houses 39 cutter discs. The rotation of the tunnel face breaks the rock, which is then scooped up by buckets and then placed onto a conveyor belt system. As it advances, TBMs progressively line the tunnel with curved concrete segments. State-of-the-art surveying technology helps track the TBMs to millimeter accuracy. A workforce of 15 operate the maintain the TBM while it is tunneling underground. So now let's follow the segments from casting to installation. 25,000 precast concrete lining segments have to be produced, and we've just ticked over 10,000 mark. Most segments to be used along this alignment are manufactured as steel fiber reinforced concrete, or SFRC. For segments around and near the cross passages, conventional reinforced concrete segments will be used. One common question I get asked is, how do we make sure the TBMs don't leak? Well, you can just see from this photo at the bottom edge to each segment is a black strip. This is actually an EPDM, or if you ask me, ethylene propylene dime monomer gasket. The gasket is precast into the segment. The force at which the TBM pushes off the segment rings when it moves forward compresses the adjoining gaskets, making a watertight seal at the outer edge of each ring. For those living and travelling on the south side of Brisbane, you may have passed some trucks recently carrying precast concrete segments. 4,157 rings and 12,500 segments will line each tunnel. The segments have a 100-year design life. Each segment is 270 millimetres thick and exactly 1.7 metres long and weighs around 4 tonnes. 6 segments make a complete ring, and it takes about 40 minutes for the TBM to place 1 ring of 6 precast segments. 105,000 cubic metres of concrete will be used to create the TBM tunnel precast segments. The photo on the left is a segment multi-service vehicle, or MSV. These vehicles deliver segments stored on the surface down to the TBMs. The photo on the right shows the TBM segment quick unloader. The yellow looking claws you see picks up the 3 segments off the MSV, lifts it up so that the MSV drives back out to the surface. From the quick unloader, the segments are lifted by a vacuum plate on a gantry rail and placed onto the segment feeder. The segments are then conveyed forward to a segment erector. The segment erector picks up each segment by vacuum suction. That's 4 tons of weight it can pick up. The erector arm can spin pretty much 360 degrees, extend and install each of the 6 segments to complete a ring. So once a ring has been installed, the TBM retracts the gripper shoe, then the auxiliary thrust cylinders push against the edge of the just installed ring and pushes the entire machine, remember, it's 1,350 tons of metal, forward by another 1.7 meters because that's the exact width of a segment. And the entire process is repeated again, 4,170 times per TBM. Now, there's also the business of the overcut. For crossfer rail, the external diameter of each ring is 6.91 meters. However, the cutterhead diameter is slightly bigger at 7.23 meters. So once the ring is installed, there's a void between the outside face of the segment to the excavated rock surface. To stabilize the mass outside the tunnel and to minimize any risk of sediment, the void is injected and filled with grout. During construction, dust is extracted to provide fresh air and protect the crews in the tunnel from excessive dust inhalation, fumes, oxygen depletion, and excessive heat. So separate systems for both air supply and extraction must be provided. This extracted air must also be treated before it is discharged to the atmosphere. So large units known as scrubbers clean this air prior to its discharge. And as the TBM moves forward, all the backup systems to operate the TBM needs to be extended in a coordinated manner, or else the TBM excavation will come to a complete halt. Some of those critical services requiring systematic and routine extensions to keep the TBM operating 24/7 are grout, the extension of the grout pipes, conveyor belts and rollers, ventilation, the electrical wiring, the H for high voltage, compressed air, cooling water, and of course, the on-time deliveries of the precast segments by the MSVs. The photo on the left is a ventilation cassette. Each cassette stores 100 meters of ventilation ducting. And on the right photo is a coiled belt for the conveyor extension. Each belt extension stores 500 meters of belt. A critical safety feature on each of the TBMs is the refuge chamber. In the event of a tunnel emergency during construction, the chamber can safely shelter up to 24 TBM personnel for up to 28 hours. The chamber features a number of life support systems, including oxygen supplies and a carbon dioxide scrubbing system to regenerate the air as they shelter in the refuge. In addition, the chamber maintains positive internal pressure at all times. This photo here shows one of the people carriers, which carried 20 passengers at a time from the surface down into the tunnels. Not passengers, workers. And they hop off at the back of the TBMs to start the shifts or catch it on the return to the surface. All TBM excavation is assessed under a permit to tunnel or PTT process. The PTT is an instruction outlining all requirements during the time frame of its validity. It considers the appropriate tunnel segment support class to be installed, the length of advance, and the requirement to install monitoring devices. And will also review results from installed monitoring devices to ensure the tunneling excavation is behaving as expected. Monitoring methods in use are sediment pins used for ground sediment, piezometers to monitor the groundwater level, convergence pins inside the tunnel to ensure that there's no ring deformation, and obviously there's visual inspection on any deformation. TBM ELSA was launched in February this year, and TBM EARL was in this month. Both machines are expected to complete tunneling at the northern portal by the end of this year. Along the way, ELSA and MERL will break through at Albert Street and Roma Street station caverns. The caverns at these stations are currently being excavated by roadheaders. To date, TBM ELSA has excavated approximately 450 metres and MERL has excavated about 70 metres. At the same time, from the Woolloongabba's southern cavern, two roadheaders are excavating the 870 metres of mine tunnel to the south. These are also expected to break through at Boggo Road Station at the end of this year. With all these mega machines operating in unison, it certainly is exciting times across the rail, and it's aptly described as the year of tunnelling. So what happens when the TBMs break through? Apologies in advance, this next video is a bit grainy because it's quite an old project I was on, so hope it works. Right. So one of the most exciting part of working in tunnels is the chance to see something like this, to see the tunnel boring machines breaking through at the end of its journey. It never ceases to amaze me as an engineer being involved with all the complex design issues to see these gigantic machines fulfill what's been drawn and designed on paper into a remarkable piece of subterranean infrastructure. I really get goosebumps just thinking about it. Along the tunnel alignment, cross passages are located approximately every 240 metres. Cross passages are a passageway from one mainline tunnel to the other. Cross passages are an important fire and life safety feature for an operational tunnel. In the event of an emergency or incident in the tunnel, when passengers are required to evacuate from a stationary train, passengers will disembark, walk along the tunnel walkway to the nearest cross passage and exit the incident tunnel and cross over into the non-incident tunnel. Once the TBMs have broken through at Albert Street, construction of the cross passages can commence. The process requires the removal of the precast segments at the cross passage locations. Additional structural support to the collars will be installed. Then it's the process of excavation. Depending on the geology, it may require rock hammering, drill and blast, or wire rope saw. So another common question is, where does all the spoil go? This is the back of TBM Elsa's conveyor belt system. And those two tall towers of blue containers are the loop take-up for the TBM's conveyor belts. Each tower stores 500 metres of pre-tensioned conveyor belt to be progressively extended as the TBM travels forward. So the TBMs can excavate 250 metres before another row of belt has to be installed. The TBMs will generate 290,000 cubic metres of spoil. And the TBMs will work at a rate of approximately 20 to 30 metres a day. The spoil is scooped up from the front of the cutter head in front of the TBM, and then it's transferred onto the TBM's conveyor system and then onto a continuous conveyor system all the way to the surface and dropped into the spoil acoustic shed located at the surface. The spoil shed is 49 metres long, 39 metres wide, and about 22 metres high. Inside the shed, two front end loaders pick up the spoil and load up truck and trailers, and then it is transported to several approved disposal sites to be used as clean landfill material. Another question is, what happens to the TBMs when they are finished? Normally with most major tunnelling projects, the procurement of any TBM would include a buyback clause. So after these machines have finished their journey to the Northern Portal, these will be extracted from the ground in large parts. Unless there's another similar size tunnelling project in the future, the Cross River Rail contractor may exercise their buyback clause and sell these machines back to Heron Connect. A bit like selling an old used car. So by the end of this year, some of the key milestones are all four underground stations to be excavated, twin tunnels dug through to the northern portal, major construction underway at Exhibition Station, work underway at Yeronga, Fairfield and Yeronga Pilly, and the ETCS train fitment underway at Redbank.